Well, thank you, Paul Geim. I have known Paul Geim for a little less than my 100 years, but not much less. I have known him from our first encounter as a solid, as a stubborn defender of the biblical narrative, as he understands it. And I honor that. And in this place, he has held forth for many, not just years, but decades. It is still known as Paul Geim's Sabbath School. And I thank you, Paul, for giving me this opportunity to bring a little of my own past to friends. Some of your faces I recognize well. Some of your faces are unfamiliar, and so I will make no apologies to you. But I have been here at Loma Linda since 1969. I came here from the American University of Beirut, where I had spent 13 years in the School of Medicine in Beirut, Lebanon. A privileged place to be, and in many ways a delightful place to be. It was only after I'd been there a while that I learned that that school, that university, was founded in 1865 by American Protestant missionaries, and until 1920 it had been known as the Syrian Protestant College, that had a medical school since the 1860s. So it has a long, rich tradition of academic leadership in the Middle East. What I came to discover was that in the 1890s, way back then in the 1890s, the campus had a major schism. It was disrupted because a major part of the well-educated faculty had embraced the teachings of Charles Darwin. And yet, the university founders had come from a very conservative, Christian, Bible-focused background, and they were unwilling to allow these dissident professors to determine the teachings, the curriculum, and the philosophy of the school. So all I can say is that the conflicts that arise within academia about marrying what Paul just mentions just now as the differences of view between scholarship and the Bible record, that's been around a long time. And in Beirut, this thing was settled because most of the dissident faculty resigned and disappeared in one direction or another. I don't think that's likely to happen at Loma Linda University. Anyway, my own experience, my own background, and believe me, to some considerable extent, what I will be sharing with you this morning is a sort of personal history, my own journey of understanding as I have studied and read and listened over decades to come where I am today. And I'm only half sure of where I am today, except for one thing. I've discovered from doing my family history, gone back to the origin of the Brandstaters in East Prussia. When I went back there, I learned that they had been a part of 20,000 Protestant believers in Western Austria, in Salzburg and around there, who had been expelled from Austria, expelled from that area, and obliged to, they were dispossessed, and they had to take their children by the hand, tramp up the highway to Protestant territory, the first main city being Leipzig, where they were welcomed by a cantata conducted by Johann Sebastian Bach. Yes, and they ended up in East Prussia. But when I went back to Salzburg to find what kind of Christian faith did these people bring with them from East Prussia? First of all, their ancestors came from Salzburg, and it was a sturdy Protestant conviction. And for that sake, they were expelled from Austria by the Catholic Archbishop of Salzburg, whose name was Leopold Firmian. Anyway, that's irrelevant here. But those ardent and very robust believers joined a whole shipload of emigrants leaving East Prussia in 1871, just at the end of the Franco-Prussian War, because they had three sons, and they, in the highly militaristic climate of East Prussia, every young man was expected to spend probably 7 years in the army, where warfare meant bayonet fighting. It wasn't fun. And those Christian believers were, many of them were pacifists and very unwilling to have their young lads, 10 years old, destined to spend all those years in the military. Anyway, they arrived in Australia, and I mustn't dwell on this too long, but my great-grandfather, Emmanuel Brandstater, with his son, turned out to be the earliest converts to Adventism after listening to preaching by visiting preachers from California. They were Adventist preachers. And they turned around and they built, that is, Emmanuel, my great-grandfather, they built the first Seventh-day Adventist church building in Australia. So you see, my roots kind of get down there rather deep. And they brought with them from East Prussia and from Salzburg way back a very deep attachment to Scripture and its truth. And when I went back to Salzburg to really get to the roots of the matter, what kind of Christian faith did those Salzburger Protestants take with them when they were expelled from Austria? They told me. I learned from a historian there. They were descendants of refugees who had fled from northern Italy because they and their ancestors had been persecuted and sometimes massacred by the representatives of the Pope and the Duke of Savoy. Got the picture? We call them today the Waldensians. So my friends, you don't easily persuade Bernard Brandstater to play games with the biblical text. My ancient ancestors wandered around where they could in Europe with a copy of the scriptures in their pockets and sharing the word of God with people where they went. And so when it comes to the book of Genesis, I am not easily swayed from a simple-minded reading of what the text says. On the other hand, I am grateful that the church in which I grew and in which I came to a mature reflection of what my faith meant to me, I was grateful to be fellowshipping with knowledgeable people who had a diversity of conclusions, having studied widely and deeply and well, so that I wasn't locked into anything that was absurd. That we had freedom in our Adventist community. We had not subscribed to what is commonly known as verbal inerrancy. We have to be willing to look at the English translations, whether it's the Masoretic or the Septuagint, yes, or the other versions, even the Latin Vulgate. I did 4 years of high school Latin, but I do not read the Vulgate. Anyway, that's my background. I went to medical school in Adelaide University, and after all, I had never, until I came to learn Melinda, I had never worked in, studied in, or taught in an Adventist institution. So I really was fresh meat. I did not know what to expect, except that for years before coming here, and from my years in Beirut in particular, I had heard a lot about Loma Linda, and it was sort of viewed as the New Jerusalem. And so I had high expectations of coming here. But when I went to medical school as a freshman student, age 16, sorry about that, but it's true, I sat in class with a professor of biology. She was a botanist, actually. Patricia Mawson was her name. She was a daughter of a famous Antarctic explorer, Sir Douglas Mawson, a great geologist. And his daughter was a tall, red-headed woman, so tall, spoke with great dignity and assurance, and she presented her lectures on botany in my classes in a strong evolutionary context. And I'll never forget the day when I was in class looking down through the microscope and trying to draw whatever it was under the microscope, and Patricia Mawson was strolling up and down the aisles behind us, and she stopped behind me. She looked down and she asked me very simply, "Are you seeing what you're looking for, Brandstater?" In Australia, you don't call people by their first names. It's always surname. I said, "Oh, yes." I said, "I think I am." But then in a wave of recklessness, I said to her, "But I'm not so sure about all this evolution stuff." This woman had all the authority that it took. With one word, she could have failed me in the course and made me repeat the year or something else worse. And she was tall and very domineering and robust in her declarations. And there was a pause behind me, and Patricia Mawson, this feared female professor, red-headed, leaned down until her face was close to my ear, and she said to me, "Yes, it is ridiculous, isn't it?" My friends, at that moment, at age 16, I made a solid resolution that never again, or never, would I hide my convictions needlessly. Hey, come down many years. Through the University of Pennsylvania, through Beirut, Lebanon, where I met the Geraghty family, amongst others. And There, as I told you earlier, I became aware that that campus, the American University of Beirut, had experienced in the 1890s a deep division of faculty opinion. So this was a problem. It didn't involve me then. There was no controversy when I was there. I didn't know what to expect when I came to Loma Linda. Now, I'm dwelling too much in the past, and my talk this morning was titled, rather provocatively or ambitiously, The Future of Adventist Creationism. And so we need to know, though, where we've come from, where we are today, before we can even think about the future and where we're going. I arrived here, and in one of the first months I was here, I went to a lecture on dermatology by Dr. Moliris Couperus. And those of you who remember that man, there aren't too many of you who are old enough. I can see one or two hands going up. I think only one of you outclasses me when it comes to seniority, and that is a revered colleague, Dr. Roth. And he knows everybody that's worth knowing. Thank you, Ariel. But Dr. Couperus was one of the early contributors to the active discussions among scholarly young Adventists in Boston and elsewhere. And he came to the conclusion, for good scientific reasons, that the 6,000-year history of planet Earth was simply unsupported by the data that came from various sources. Along came the son of the much revered missionary Eric Hare. His name was Edgar P. I think they all called him Peter Hare. And Peter Hare was a scientist, and he did original work in the Carnegie Institute, I believe it was called. And his work in biochemistry and in the rate of racemization of amino acids in certain proteins, it led him to the conclusion, very honest conclusion, that the age of planet Earth had to be much longer than the 6,000-year structure that was prevalent at that era in the Adventist church. All right, that was Peter Hare, and you didn't dismiss Peter Hare's conclusions in that era, not easily. I didn't have any opinions of my own, so that's not a part of my own story. Then along came a report of a fossil forest that had been revealed by geologists and explorers in Yellowstone. Fossil forests, and the expert geologists concluded that this mountainside of fossil trees represented a history of successions of forests of trees that would go back many thousands of years. In other words, the age of planet Earth was inevitably much longer than in our church most people were considering. There were successes that geological conclusion really provoked the church leaders in wherever they were. And they sent Richard Ritland, who was an early leader in the Geoscience Research Institute, they sent him up to Yellowstone to examine the fossil forests for himself and to bring back a report. And that report was given back at Andrews in Berrien Springs in 1963, just as chance or providence would have it, I was in the Rickland house that evening when he sat down and made his presentation to church leaders, and in that group was none other than Francis D. Nicol and Alonzo Baker. These are grand old men in the apologetic side of the Adventist Church. And I was impressed by Rickland's report, which really took no issue apart from the opinion of geologists that chronology would take us way, way back. Now you're understanding. Here I am, I'm just a newcomer, hearing things for the first time. And Alonzo Baker, when I was still in medical school, I still have vivid recollections of picking up a small booklet in my pastor father's library. It was a report, if you please, of a public debate given and reported widely in the media between the country and the world's foremost paleontologist, G. Gaylord Simpson by name, a Harvard man. And he was being debated by two spokesmen from the Seventh-day Adventist Church, namely Francis D. Nicol and Alonzo Baker. And as a teenage student, as I was at the time, when I read that thing, that's when I came to the conclusion, this is a serious subject, clearly, between what the church has taught and what science is teaching, it's in wide variance. So we can't ignore this. We have to work on it. And it was that triggered me to respond, as I did, to Patricia Mawson. Anyway, now we're in Loma Linda, and I'm starting to hear all kinds of reports. I heard the lecture on dermatology from Aliris Couperus, who spoke without any explanation of long ages of the human race on planet Earth. So I knew that the long age of the Earth was an acceptable thing for a Loma Linda University professor to refer to. Hey, where have we come? I need to quickly go through the step-by-step, man-by-man, person-by-person development of various views and come down to the present time where we stand. And I in order that we won't get too deeply locked in, I have to admit to you that I have watched the controversies over the years I have been, many years in Loma Linda, with some dismay, because I was open to listen to whatever seemed to make sense to me and what was well supported. On the other hand, I was very reluctant to let go of what had been deep convictions in me from childhood, in fact. And what came to me, of course, I heard lectures from the Geoscience Research Institute. I was impressed by the fact that from 1969, when I reached this town, until this day, until today, I can remember only one purposeful weekend event given to creationism in the Adventist context. Paul will remember that. I know that he was involved in that event. But the Geoscience Research Institute was established a long time ago, but its assignment was not to be evangelistic, but to be advisory to the church leaders. They had an advisory role, and they've done that well. But they have not been in the front line of the expositors and the apologists. That has been my impression. What has changed the scenery for me has been the arrival on the scene of what is now known as the intelligent design movement. I'm sure that in this place, with Paul Geams jostling and leadership here, you've heard a lot about intelligent design. And I brought here a fraction of about the 500 books that I've accumulated through all these years. And many of them are within the field of intelligent design. And what that whole movement has done for me is that it has first of all, it has addressed the question that has vexed the world of science versus the world of Christendom, and that is there indeed a God? Who is the author? Who is the source of all life? Who is the author of the cosmos indeed? And that has been the traditional church teaching, and it certainly has been what I grew up with. And the intelligent design movement, from its beginnings, has had one objective, and that is to provide scientific evidence, data, that shows convincingly that what we see around us, the world, even the planetary system, planet Earth, and the life within it, could not have ever arrived by accident, by chance. There had to have been intelligent design at work to bring that to pass. And the proponents of intelligent design refused to identify the designer or introduce the concept of creation. It's a word they strictly avoid using because they want the movement of intelligent design to be the big tent that will accommodate a wide variety of opinions. The intelligent design movement had its beginnings back in 1986 when a biochemistry professor in New Zealand named Michael Denton wrote a book, which I've probably got here somewhere. Yes, Michael Denton was his name, and he wrote a book provocatively titled Evolution, A Theory in Crisis. Now, this was not based primarily in biochemistry, but it was a powerful book. And even today, when you read it, you will find that there is in this book, 1986 now, powerful evidence that challenges the theory of evolution as it was then taught, what we call Neo-Darwinism. That is the combination of mutations and variation and mutations. Anyway, this was Michael Denton's first venture, and I don't know whether it made a big hit when it appeared, except that it did in one direction, and that is the book was in a bookshop window in Oxford, England, when a professor of law from Berkeley named Philip Johnson was on sabbatical in Oxford. Walking along the street one day, he saw this book in the window by Michael Denton, and he was intrigued by it. And being on sabbatical, he had no heavy burdens. He bought a copy and he read it. And with his expertise in law, because his field was weighing and evaluating the weight of evidence, whether it was strong or mediocre or weak, evaluating evidence in the court of law. That was his specialty. And it didn't take Philip Johnson long to realize that the evidence in the theory of evolution was in fact remarkably weak. And he wrote a book which he titled Darwin on Trial. Now, take it or leave it. That was a declaration of war in a way. And it wasn't long before Johnson gathered around him a group of young enthusiasts who also, from different perspectives, had been disenchanted or driven away from the teachings of established science that, in fact, was methodological naturalism, which excluded divine intervention in the cosmos. Now, you can see I've reviewed the history of my own journey, and now you will see, if you ever have time to take the to come and see what's on the shelf here. The latest book was one I acquired this past week by its author. I have to thank Leonard Brand for this, because he teamed up with Arthur Chadwick from Southwestern Adventist University, have produced this third edition of the book, Faith, Reason, and Earth History. And I haven't had time yet to read it and digest it. All I know is that from what I have read in the previous edition, it is a book which is a very fair presentation of the evidence on both sides of the issues. And so when you've saved up and have some time to spare, I can recommend that book to you. However, there is a book that far anteceded that book, and that is a book by another young Adventist, or erstwhile Adventist, called Ronald Numbers. Ronald Numbers wrote this book, which is no light-hearted book either, 500 pages of it, The Creationists. This is the expanded edition, published in 2003. And this brings us up to date with more recent advances in what has happened in the community of creationists. That's Ronald Numbers. I must say, from my review of this book in the past week, I've been deeply impressed with Numbers' detailed acquaintance with the literature. He has read extensively, and of course, because he was a Branson relative, a member of the family, he had ready access to all the documents in the General Conference files, and he was able to attribute the whole creation enterprise in large measure to Adventist pioneers, starting with George McCready Price. Now, there we are. Denton, Ron Numbers, and what was I handling here before? Oh, Denton, Numbers, and doesn't matter. The two books that I have been most moved by in the last, I would say, 3 weeks, I have here in my hand. One is this black book here. It's called Mind and Cosmos. Mind and Cosmos by Thomas Nagel. Thomas Nagel is a professor of philosophy at New York University. And he is widely quoted very well known in the community of philosophers. And you know, that's not a community to be sneezed at. That's an egghead community if you're looking for one. And Thomas Nagel has as a subtitle for his book, Mind and Cosmos, Why the Materialist Neo-Darwinian Conception of Nature is Almost Certainly False. Here's a philosopher who is an avowed atheist, who is nevertheless saying that Darwinism and all of the accretions around it is almost certainly false. And what he says over here interested me. Talking about the alternatives to evolution and atheism, and talking about intelligent design, he says, I can first confess to an ungrounded assumption of my own in not finding it possible to regard the design alternative as a real option. He is, just because of his own prejudices, he's finding intelligent design impossible to digest. You got the strength of that? A great scholar dismissing intelligent design because it meant admitting to the actual existence of a divinity, of God. Nagel is not prepared to do that, but he spent this whole book in pleading and indeed insisting that the whole edifice of Charles Darwin's evolution and all of its consequences, they're vast. The whole of modern biology is significantly dependent on Charles Darwin. It falls down flat if you listen to Nagel. Nagel, of course, when he published this book just very few years ago, he was roundly abused because of his scholarship, but they criticized him personally. It was an ad hominem response. It was not any analysis or rejection of his logic. That was Thomas Nagel. Now, the other book, this man dismisses or tosses aside the godlessness of modern science. And what he is saying, and he says it explicitly, I meant to read this as a footnote here to that preface that I was reading. I'm not just unreceptive, that is, to intelligent design. I'm not just unreceptive, he says, but I am strongly averse to the idea. That's Nagel speaking. He is complimenting the intelligent design movement because it has opened the way for a discussion of expanded possibilities rather than being locked in to the methodological naturalism, which excludes anything except nature as we have become familiar with it ever since Isaac Newton. Okay. Now, the other book that I must share with you is this book. And I know that those of you who have been frequently in this Sabbath school, you have really had a heavy dose of of Douglas Axe. Douglas Axe is a young scientist who got a PhD from Caltech. They don't give them away at Caltech. So he's a substantial scientist. And because from his studies at Caltech, he came to the conclusion that things are not as simple as the atheistic structure of science would have us believe. He wanted to have more room to consider options. He was accepted for postdoc research in Cambridge University in England. And he went there and stayed there for several years. Cutting my story short, Douglas Axe was a biochemist, and he wanted to know how specific was the sequence of amino acids in certain proteins. Now, in the familiar Krebs cycle, without which we would crump, you have to have an active Krebs cycle with all of its steps and enzymes and substrates. You'd have to have very specific protein structures to function successfully to generate energy, an ATP in your cell organism. Douglas Axe went to work to see how precise had to be the sequence of amino acids in these proteins. Now, the reason why Axe's work was absolutely new and unattempted previously, the reason is that only in recent years have we had the capacity to sequence proteins, and within a reasonable period of time to actually know what the sequence of amino acids was in the structure of a certain protein. And Douglas Axe decided that he would test certain enzyme proteins by manipulating the sequence of amino acids and substituting one or two amino acids for those that existed originally in the enzyme protein. How are we, Paul? Is my watch? Yes, it's all right. Okay, thank you. We will have as much time as you care to take to explore other things. And anyway, it turned out that Douglas Axe verified from his research that even the substitution of a very limited amino acid or two in one of these critical proteins in the cell metabolism, that very small substitution resulted in a failure of function. The cell could not continue. And in using modern technology in his laboratory in Cambridge, he was able to verify that the amino acid sequence in these proteins was absolutely critical, just like the letters you type when you're sending an email. If you have one letter that's wrong in the address, you know what happens to it. It just bounces back to you. Happens to me all the time. And what Axe determined was that the proteins, of which there are hundreds, maybe even thousands, in some cells of our bodies, enormously complex. They are not just complex in a general kind of way, but specifically complex. They must have the amino acids in absolutely precise order, or else the cell could not function. And what impressed me about Douglas Axe was that as the youngest and most recent researcher in the intelligent design movement, he was willing to do something that none of his predecessors, not Dembski, William Dembski, whom I've got to know fairly well, and others, Philip Johnson, who was the founder of the movement, professor of law from UC Berkeley. He's been my house guest in Redlands. He's been to Loma Linda and has lectured here on campus. And one of Philip Johnson's proteges was John Mark Reynolds, professor of philosophy at Biola University. I got to know John Mark Reynolds pretty well. He and his family were my guests in Redlands again. He lectured here. In fact, I'll never forget the Sabbath morning when he lectured up in the Coleman Pavilion, and John Mark Reynolds was one of the most fluent and most articulate men I've ever met. He had spent 9 years qualifying in analytic philosophy at the University of Rochester. He's a scholar. And he admitted to me, when he and I got to know each other pretty well, his grandfather had been an Adventist, not a Seventh-day Adventist, but one of the others who had survived from the disappointment in the 1840s and had still maintained a community. That was his grandfather. And when I visited John Mark Reynolds in his office at Biola, we were planning a lecture trip, he and I and his wife, the three of us, to Australia. All on my bill, by the way. He lectured 5 hours at Avondale College, John Mark Reynolds did. But when I visited him in his office at Biola, I looked behind his office door and was very impressed to see pinned to the back of his office door was a copy of William Miller's prophetic chart. I thought, hey, all truths never die, do they? And yet, of course, he became, under Philip Johnson's tutelage, he became an ardent creationist of a young earth variety, but because he's a philosopher and not a scientist, he decided that he really didn't belong in scientific discussions because he would be outclassed. And so he withdrew, and he became provost at Baptist University in Houston, Texas. Back to Douglas Arch. He did what Johnson and what Dembski and what others in the movement did not do. He dared to say the probabilities are so remote that any of these precise sequences of amino acids could lead to a functioning cell that it is impossible. And he actually used his study in mathematics to calculate the probabilities. And like Dembski before him, Dembski, I remember, I'm quoting him now, quoted the improbabilities as one chance in one times 10 to the 70th power. 10 to the 70th, my friends, is a lot of possibilities. 1 to the 70th. Actually, 10 to the 70th, Dembski said in one of his chapters, is the total number of particles, atomic particles, in the visible universe. Got that? Not just sands on the sea. The number of particles, atomic particles, in the visible universe. It is an absurd number to even contemplate. But that's where the improbabilities of chance leading to the created world that we see and the life within it. And Douglas Arch echoed that conclusion because of his own research in protein. Paul, I can't even see a clock. And I don't trust my watch. Oh, thank you. All right. Good. Well, I have sort of reviewed in this limited time some of the steps that have led to my convictions as they are today. What is the creationism scene, and where does our Adventist Church fit into it? And what may I ask you, what reasonable and defensible position can our church as an entity, can it take that it can defend without apologizing to the world of scholarship? Our church has, last time I heard, about 106 college and university campuses around the world. 106 colleges and university campuses. And these tertiary education institutions all must teach science. They must teach biology. They must teach science and chemistry. And what kind of science should they teach? At what point do they introduce the hand of an intervening creator, God, who after all was the author and finisher, completer of the cosmos. Puzzling with these issues and not knowing what to do because my mind from school days still was locked into Isaac Newton, and maybe a little in a lapsed moment I would give some credence to Einstein, although with some reservations. But Einstein himself was kind of sideswiped when quantum theory showed up. And I think you've heard a little bit of quantum theory here. I know I've been here once or twice when it was even mentioned, and I would like to challenge Paul Geim to give us a nice compact summary of quantum theory. I have read some stuff. Here's a book which is a magnificent book and has blessed me a lot. Quantum theory just does not make sense to the well-informed mind that is locked into Newton, as I am, Newtonian physics. And even Einstein could not swallow quantum theory. He knew from the data from the laboratory that there was strong laboratory confirmation of quantum theory. But Einstein said to his dying day, "It is not wrong, but it's not complete." He gave himself an out, you see. This book is called Quantum Glory. Now, imagine what that's all about. This man is an evangelical, charismatic Christian who has studied enough quantum physics to find a way in which, out of quantum theory, we can find reasonable connections between modern physics, which is represented by quantum mechanics, quantum theory, and the miracles, the supernatural events, which you and I, as Bible-adhering Christians, we just accept because they're in the Word of God. Turning water into wine. If you stop to think about what that required, you know, what you had to do to change transparent water into stuff which had red color, what kind of molecular changes, and beneath the molecules, what kind of atomic changes were required to produce the red color in the wine and to produce the flavor which was so widely commended in Cana of Galilee. Hey, that's just one simple miracle. But beyond that, on Galilee, when it was stormy, Jesus just said, "Peace be still." The forces of nature submitted to the word of a divine person there in the boat. Now you see, since we don't have any serious issues there, maybe some of you may, but I have never questioned the miracles in Jesus' own ministry, then I come back and I read quantum mechanics, and when I read about entanglement, do you know what entanglement is? I'll bet you've talked about it here. When you have two subatomic particles in that are closely connected, and then you separate them by a significant distance. If you make a change of some kind, a change of spin to one of those particles, and the other particle is being observed, there is simultaneously, instantly, a consequent and comparable change in the other particle. And if it is the distance between Los Angeles and New York, thousands of miles. Even, physicists tell us, even if the particles are between Los Angeles and the moon. The communication is instantaneous. No delay. Have you ever wondered what happens when we sit at a meal table and bow our heads to say grace silently? Seriously, my friends, I'm speaking to you now as a very humble and faith-led Adventist Christian. We are saying, by articulating mentally our thanks to God for the food, we're saying that we believe that through some mechanism which we cannot imagine, the movement of electrons in our neurons are being observed and interpreted and are flying from here to wherever he is. You know, it's just beyond conception if we dare to even think about it. And yet, in a conference I attended at Glacier View, I attended a conference of cosmologists, astronomers, all Adventists, by the way, who were arguing about the believability of miracles in our group discussion. And yet when we had lunch, they all did the same thing. They bowed their heads and said grace in their minds, saying by their actions that they were willing, you see, to give credence. Now, you won't have a chance. We cannot even do any more. But let me tell you what's here. My most recent paper was one I just kind of fine-tuned yesterday. It's called A Loud Voice for Adventist Creationism. And that title comes from, you guessed it, Revelation 14, verse 7. And I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell in the earth, unto every kindred, nation, tongue, and people. Or maybe the other way around. Saying with a loud voice, fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come, and worship him who made heaven and earth, the sea, and the fountains of waters. Hey, I learned that when I was this big. Still up there somewhere. I don't know anywhere else in Scripture where it says that in the last days, and that's what we're talking about here, what our church has always said, the three angels' messages of Revelation 14 are the last end times message which our church feels obliged to share and to preach. What is the content of the first angel's message? Saying with a loud voice, the loud voice, fear God and give glory to him and worship him who made heaven and earth, the sea and the fountains of waters. It's a creation message. It's a declaration to unbelievers that they'd better wake up and take notice. Even if they're not totally rejecting God, they're nevertheless ignoring him. And today, our culture, this country of ours, like Europe, like Australia, has entered into an era of semi-paganism. We may not just dismiss God, but we ignore him. We regard him as being irrelevant to our daily lives and someone that we can just do without. I think this message, fear God and give glory to him, is the first angel's message, and it's the one that I would put as the number one message that ought to be up front as signifying, as representing what Seventh-day Adventists represent. We represent and we defend and we declare not just any old God, but a God who was the creator God. The God of Jonah, when the Phoenician sailors challenged him, "Who are you?" Oh, he said, "I'm a Hebrew. I worship the God of the Hebrews who made heaven and earth and the seas." They toss him overboard anyway. And centuries later, Paul on Mars Hill, confounded with the place where there was no sculpture and it was to the unknown God, he told the philosophers, "I'll tell you who he is." And he quoted, and you can read it in Acts chapter 17. "I'll tell you who he is. He is the God who made heaven and earth." In Jonah's day, in Paul's day, the one true God was the Creator God. That was the basis of his claim to worship. And friends, my final comment comes from Revelation chapter 4, verse 11. Because there the 24 elders and four beasts are on their faces bowing before him who sat on the throne. And they are saying, "Thou art worthy, thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive honor and glory and majesty and power. For why? For thou hast created all things." God's claim to the respect and honor of his whole creation indeed. And certainly, he imposes upon you and me, I believe, to find ways to defend his identity as the one true God, and to find ways to declare that. And what I like about the first angel's message, the very first word is, "Fear God." Fear God. That attention getter wasn't relevant when I was a boy, when I was 12 years old in school, because all of my friends at school, public school in Australia, they all went to Sunday school. They were good Anglicans, most of them. And so society as a whole was still Christianized when I was a kid. You understand what I'm saying? And I can still remember standing at the entrance to the big tent pitched in the city of Wollongong, south of Sydney, Australia, when as a 10-year-old, I would stand there and hand out hymn books to all the people who walked in off the street. And lo and behold, my mother was playing the piano inside, and all these people, just street people, would sing hymns because they knew the hymns. In other words, society was Christianized. Today, it is a totally de-Christianized society. No one, the media that we read and the magazines and the newspapers, they dismiss any kind of divinity, certainly any kind of creator. And so it is a society which ignores God, and that's what I like about the first angel's message. It's a message I wish we could find a way to put that up front as what Adventists have to say to the world. Quit ignoring your Creator. There is nothing that you can do that is greater mockery to the God who made you. Wake up, listen, because he is not only your Creator, he is your judge, and he's coming. Do you understand? That's why I believe that creation, in whatever formulation we may find for it, it is still the very heart and core of who I am as the Seventh-day Adventist. Thank you much.
It is past 11:30, and I know some of you have places to go, so those of you who wish to can leave now without having to be embarrassed. But for those of you who wish to stay, I will allow Bernard to entertain questions until he throws up his hands and quits.
He said,
that's threatening.
Questions. Well, please entertain us with questions.
We may be here all week. That rate. Yes.
Is this working? Yeah. I certainly respect and honor you for your commitment and the evidence that lies behind it in today's presentation, as well as your whole life really has been committed to the first angel's message. My question is, does that include a defense of 6,000 years?
You all know who the questioner is, Dr. Lawrence Geraghty, erstwhile president of La Sierra University, now president emeritus, and man of many parts. He is most comfortable when he has a pick and shovel in his hand. Larry? There was a time when I felt obliged, just from my upbringing, to subscribe to a 6,000 years history. But I have, of course, I have become familiar with the Septuagint translation and the variability, the significant variations in chronology, so that my mathematics don't stretch to 6,000. But also, I have become aware of the opinions expressed by people like Ron Osborne, another scion of a Middle Eastern family, and a good scholar with a doctorate in I don't know what. But he has published outside the Adventist publishing system and advocates the existence of life before Adam and Eve, which would mean an extension of the Earth's chronology since the so-called the fall, as we refer to it. And yet, let me add one further comment. As I have examined up close the new physics involving atomic theory, in which Einstein had a lot to do in the early years, and he built his special theory of relativity on Max Planck, as you doubtless know. It wasn't very long before quantum theory appeared on the scene, and then there followed a long-lasting controversy between Einsteinian theory and the theories of quantum mechanics and the great Copenhagen leader of the physicists there, Niels Bohr by name, who eventually formulated his concept of how the atom was constructed. And physicists finally came to the conclusion that the atom was almost all space. Almost all of the mass in an atom was in the nucleus. And so when you start reducing matter down to its basics, you're almost left with nothing except energy fields. Energy fields. What's an energy field? Magnetism is an energy field. You can't see it, you can't photograph it, except you can easily demonstrate it with iron filings. What about gravity? That's another field. What anchors me to the floor as I walk around here? It's gravity. A very weak force, by the way, but it is what maintains the planets in their orbits, what maintains the moon circulating around the Earth. And we know that it was Copernicus who helped us get our solar system straightened out. Now I'm still answering. But I guess I ought to come back to my previous train of thought, and that is that when I got deeply into the into what seem to be absurdities in quantum theory and yet confirmed in the laboratory, beyond serious question, I say to myself, hey, if modern physicists can swallow entanglement and just dismiss it by saying, we don't understand it, we just know it's real, why can't I accept the fact that water can be changed to wine? I don't understand it. And when Lazarus was restored from death after 4 days of being in the tomb, what was required to do that? Because all of the proteins in Lazarus' body had surely been disrupted by then. It was a new creation. But the new creation of Lazarus was still the brother of Mary and Martha. Understand what I'm saying? If we start accepting in faith the miracles that we have recorded in the Gospels, I shouldn't really choke on anything that the Word of God tells me happened. Now, it does describe, at least some versions of chronology describe, a very young earth. But there is so much from your discipline, which is archaeology, and so much when you look at the moon and its surface features, and when we have close-up photographs of the planet Mars, we ask ourselves, did all of this happen just 6,000 years ago? And now, I'm answering your question by pointing out that there are features in the visible planet Earth and in the solar system that seem to indicate very much an age far beyond a few thousand years. So, I'm not locked in to a conclusion, Larry. But you see, I'm willing, as I have been, to accept water into wine, and accept peace be still on Galilee, that all the elements, you see, the very forces which determine what happens in the solar system, in our bodies, in our chemistry, in our biochemistry, in our molecular function, the valences that hold atoms together and make cellular chemistry possible, the valences originally were determined by a creator who created the periodic table. You can understand that? It's too much for me to grasp. But I'm not dodging a question. I'm just saying that I think the options are still there, and when I'm dealing with a creator who started the whole thing off by conceptualizing a cosmos of matter, it's beyond my comprehension. So I say, Lord, you did it. I worship you. Thank you.
I just might add a little comment. This is, of course, is a very important issue to Adventism. We're here on this Sabbath day because we believe God created in 6 days. And we may not know exactly if it was 6,000. I don't know why it often says about and so on. She was not very precise on the figure most of the time. When you consider the alternative, is it billions of years or is it a few thousand years ago? there is some data out there that is very hard to explain unless you believe it is just a few thousand years ago. I just might mention rates of erosion of our continents way too fast. Our continents should have been eroded away at least 100 times in geologic times in these billions of years. We're still here. The geologic column is still there. We have geologists commonly talk about, the stuff was recycled from below. The whole column is still there. It's never been recycled even once. We have data that tends to support the flood, which, of course, changes the whole picture of the time for the geologic column. Incredibly widespread layers out there that totally out of character, if anything, that we see going on our continents right now. Tremendous layers, very thin layers, had to be laid out on very flat layers below them and so on, and we have gaps between these layers. According to geologic time, that are so flat, and they should have all been eroded away. You have tissue in dinosaurs that are supposed to be 90 million years now, type of thing. You have a relatively brief period for man in terms of his accomplishments, and so on, picking a significant data for man. Why is all the good data for man so recent? I'm talking about aqueducts and pyramids and not some of these questionable shelters that you're not sure what they are, or their dating and so on. But there is that data out there that is hard to explain. Unless you think, the biblical model certainly is a consideration.
Thank you, Dr. Ruth. I certainly agree, because in my reading, especially in Ron Number's book, actually, there were major debates going on in the 1940s, way back then, in your time, but not in mine.
Just you wait.
Yes. Was there planet Earth prior to the Garden of Eden and Adam and Eve? That's a big issue there, way back then. But if you want to get an overview of some of that early history, you won't do better than read Ronald Numbers, because he knew the principal actors. That his conclusions are a different story altogether. But yes, my friend Brand here, he's the responsible for this book.
Well, we had some useful discussion about the question of literal 7 days. There's another question that has to be asked, which is maybe the most important question. If there was not a literal creation, literal Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve, who sinned and brought sin into this world, then what's the need for a redeemer, and what role does Christianity have in this world?
Thank you. That's a very fundamental comment, because the whole narrative of Genesis 1, 2, and 3 determines what follows throughout the whole Bible. And if you care to, I didn't finish my introduction of these papers. This is one which discusses what the Adventist Church as a community can do. And one of the earliest comments here in this paper, Leonard, is that creation is foundational to, at least to my edifice of faith. And it's right through the Bible. You cannot play games with that without destroying the Holy Scriptures, indeed. So I'm not willing to do that. Now, here's a paper which simply gives quotations and commentary on these books, or some of them, which will give you an idea of what's inside the books. You can't read them all, but believe me, the commentary indicates the thrust and conclusions. Larry, thank you.
Sorry, I have to go, but I need your papers. Is this what, for us?
Oh, yeah, they're all for you. Okay. Yes. The last paper that Dr. Geraghty took was titled Beauty and Intelligent Design, Visioning the Personhood of God. Hey, digest those words if you can. Beauty and intelligent design, visioning the personhood of God. Can you imagine God as not just a force, but a person? Someone you can talk to? That's what this paper was all about. And actually, this paper was, with just a few minor changes, was published years and years ago in Adventist Today. And it was seriously objected to by people whose names you know. But anyway, this, you see, all of Darwinian theory is based upon natural selection or survival of the fittest. Any change in the animal world produces animal forms and species which do well to reproduce and to survive. It was fitness that Darwin's theory depended on. Fitness to survive. In fact, Richard Dawkins used the term in one of his books, the selfish gene. It was self-interest and survival that was on Dawkins' mind, and which he proposed was the basis for the whole tree of life as it stood. But in this paper, from Bernard Brandstater anyway, it proposes that as an outcome of creation, beauty is totally different than is fitness and toughness for survival purposes. Beauty has no connection with survival fitness. There is no place for beauty in the created order unless the source of beauty comes from intelligence of a different kind. And it is a loving intelligence, a generous intelligence that determined from the very beginning to endow humans, you and me, with sensory apparatus in our ears, our ossicles, in our eyes, in the proteins of vision, rhodopsin and so on. All of these things were given to us not by accidental mutation in evolution. That's impossible. But by a purposeful endowment by the Creator intended to enrich our lives and give us aesthetic delight. And I take the liberty of adding to that, and I picture Adam and Eve walking with God in the Garden of Eden and enjoying all that they see happening around them. What a marvelous picture it must have been. Can we even start to anticipate what delights may await those who enjoy the earth made new? Hey, thank you.
Can I add one comment?
Please.
I appreciated Douglas Axe and what he's done. He's been part of a crisis over evolution that's been developing for several decades and is boiling over right now. And I'm not talking about creationists versus evolutionists, but within the main scientific community, you've got now eminent molecular biologists who are not creationists writing straight out that the Darwinian theory of random mutations and natural selection cannot possibly work. We know too much about the cell to believe that that could work.
Oh, thank you. I could give a lecture on the collapse of Darwinian theory. It is It is history, basically, and we won't need to go into that.
Thank you for the presentation. Long Earth, short Earth history, a couple of things, a couple of examples. The moon is moving away from the Earth about 3 meters per century. So if we are into millions and billions of years, then moon had to be close to the Earth. Well, that poses a big problem. I'm sure you know about that. If we bring the moon half the way toward the Earth, we increase the gravitational pull 4 times. Well, then the Earth would be soaked twice a day. With high tide, low tide, it would fill up the Earth twice. Life could be pretty hard to...
Are you predicting doom and desolation, or are you asking a question?
I'm asking a question. I mean, is that possible that the Earth is really, truly billions of years old? Another point. Niagara Falls is breaking, is shortening 4.5 feet every year. So if we need this millions of years of age of the Earth, and the Niagara Falls should have been in Lake Erie. I mean,
yes. You're talking about signs that indicate, as Dr. Roth has indicated,
right,
that Niagara Falls can't have been there forever.
Right.
No, you can calculate back at the rate it's receding now. But you could do that in so many other fields. You can go back and take bores into the glaciers of Antarctica. We can't even stop. But remember, if I may comment, in general terms, the whole system, all of our solar system, including planet Earth and Mars, it was all created in a state of change. By which I mean, yes, the moon may be receding just a few centimeters a year, and maybe some meters in a century, yes. But because the system began in a state of slow but inexorable change, it can't go on forever. No. If you wait long enough, you and I won't be around. Yes, the moon... The relationship of the planetary bodies may be altogether changed. And if you're a true believer, you might even have a soft spot for Velikovsky, who wrote book Planets in Collision. And he goes back and refers to earlier times before the Earth was like it is today. There was a period, just as there will be a period, if you wait long enough, when the Earth is not like it is now, there was a period before, unless you want to take the position that Creator God just brought things into being the way we see them, with a molten, hot core for planet Earth. Maybe that's the way he did it, because he had to maintain a temperature flux somehow.
You talk about faith. People of faith, Beirut, American University in Beirut was established on faith. Our big universities in this country were all faith-based, and the scripture says, when the Lord comes back, will he find faith in the world? I'm reading a book right now. It's called I Dare to Call Him Father. Because in one major faith in this world, you cannot call the Creator a father. It's a blasphemy. Well, this lady, a very prominent lady in Pakistan, became a Christian. And what all she went through, and her faith, living faith in her, that we used to cherish as Christians all over the world, that we're giving up and going to another faith called Darwinism, when folk from other cultures, other faiths are finding their refuge and their strength in the living God. It boggles my mind.
I could comment a great deal on Islam. I lived in Beirut for 13 years. I have done a lot in the Islamic countries. And I was a guest at a big banquet in Riyadh after taking care of the King of Saudi Arabia. And one of the members of the royal cabinet, commenting on the work of the Loma Linda University heart surgery team, he said to me, loudly, in the presence of 26 or so royal princes who had all gathered around with their robes and to say thank you to Loma Linda University, he said to me, "We have been watching you, Adventists, and of all the Christians, you are the closest to Islam. Islam, the Quran teaches creation, and it teaches creation in 6 days. So you see, if Adventists can find a way to articulate proudly, without apologetic, and do it with good, solid backing, without apologies, we can declare ourselves to be creation believers. We would be so welcome in Islamic territories. A friend of mine who was a journalist in Istanbul, he's a Turkish Muslim. Oh, he told me that, this is a few years ago now, that over a period of time, during 1 year, 4,000 Turkish academics, mostly professors and senior students, gathered in various universities in Turkey. They were all Islamists. They gathered because they wanted to know more about the theory of intelligent design. In other words, they were serious about their Islamic faith. You see, they were willing to come and listen carefully to lecturers, including Philip Johnson, by the way, our friend from Berkeley, wanted to listen to them give good reasons why you cannot explain the world and its life by chance. They wanted to hear validation of the existence of not just any old God, but a God who creates. Hey. Thank you. Yes, my friend.
Just a comment here. I appreciate so much your really sharing of your soul, and that we see what makes you tick. I have a concern, really, that as a church that we have kind of muffled the voice of creationism, such as G.S. I focused on edifying the leaders of the church rather than really reaching out to all the members and to the world. And also, a few years back when the church had a Sabbath afternoon discussion on creation evolution, we heard no creationist really speaking positively for creationism.
What I hear you referring to is a very real issue, at least for me, because there seems to be a reluctance,
yes,
for sincere conservative believers to defend biblical creation. Mm-hmm. We have reservations because we may be even misinterpreting what Moses was trying to tell us. I don't know. But because I'm a Waldensian, I don't easily accept that reservation.
Because it is so fundamental to just everything, like you said, to faith itself.
Yes.
Well, at least a few of us are trying to change that.
Paul's team has been the irrepressible defender of the faith.
Uh, I do remember going to another Sabbath school a couple weeks ago or so. And I think it is high time for us to, well, first of all, know what we believe and know what evidence there is for and against it. But then beyond that, to try to allow other people to see that that we actually do have opinions that might be worthwhile.
We have lots of very good scholars in our church, Paul. And the trouble is their opinions don't all agree. But that is one of the, for me, that's one of the virtues of our community of faith.
That's right.
That we give people who are thinking for themselves enough leeway to differ and respect one another, mm-hmm. and shake hands and embrace as brothers. Mm-hmm. See, but we all, when push comes to shove, pardon my English, the time comes when we have to give instructions and guidance to our professors of physics and chemistry and biology in the college in Seoul, in Korea, or wherever we're teaching students at tertiary level, because we've got to teach our young people. And I report another fault of mine. I was so busy during the 1970s when I was a new chairman up here in the Med Center, building a department, recruiting good talent wherever I could find it, and having a marvelous time, but frantically busy. My children were at home and at school, and they were in Adventist schools. They all went through Loma Linda Academy eventually, and then either to La Sierra College or to Pacific Union College. And my son went through medical school here in Loma Linda. I can say to you with regret and sorrow that three out of my four children now, today, are not clearly identifiable as Bible-adhering Christians. They respect it all. And you know what the trouble is? When they were in their teens, Dad was too busy doing his stuff in the hospital. So there was a... And at the academy where they studied, under religion teachers and science teachers, there was no scheduled, specified program of presenting the controversies surrounding evolution and creation with a conclusion that intelligent design leaves us with no option but to embrace a divine, powerful, majestic God. Amen. You see, that's what I would like to leave with our teenagers. But I was too busy doing my stuff in the medical center. Parents have a major responsibility. And can I say, in all humble humility, I look back at those years now with pride at what was done in the medical center, but also with sadness because I did not spend enough time one-on-one with my own kids to drill them with the reasons, the solid data-based reasons why there was no room for chance, for a happenstance, for accident in the universe. That it had to come from a creator God. And so neither in school or in the Sabbath school up here on our campus was there any ever, as far as I ever knew or heard, was there ever any planned attempt to completely persuade my own teenagers of creation truth. Now, they all left the community and went their ways and followed their own careers. But I think their life story would have been very different had my own behavior as a father been different. And I have been more than you can even guess. One of my books here is Already Gone. Already Gone. And it's referring to the conclusions of psychologists and research that unless we reach our children by the age of 14, that's when their basic convictions and persuasions are settled, whether a thing is believable or not. And if you leave your indoctrining, your persuading of our children until they're at college, it's too late. They're gone. I'm sorry. But that, and this book confirms that with plenty of data to show it. So, hey, I'm sorry, I wander all
over the place. Since you wrote that book, my comment probably will not hold much water. But having from real life story, and I cannot help it but share a story with you. I worked in the ERs for 30 years in Ohio and here in California, and would have captive audience for whatever minutes in the rooms. Once I was, and I would always talk with these young kids. Very simple question: what will you do 10 years from now? I don't know what I'm doing. But anyways, this is a story I've got to share this with you. And there was an 80-year-old kid. He had a sprained ankle, so they already x-rayed. You already know their sprained ankle. So I told him what was going on, and I says, hey, listen, you're finishing high school. What will you do 10 years from now? I don't know. His dad was sitting in the corner, didn't say a word. 2 weeks later, I met him for another reason, and he says, hey, Doc, do you remember me? I was there, my son. Yeah, I remember you very well. Room 6, you were sitting in the corner. He says, you know, in those 15 minutes, you have done more for my son than I have been able to do in the last 5 years. I've also raised four kids, you know, same story. Kids, dad is not cool. Someone else is cool. The professor, biology professor is cool. Whoever else is cool. Dad is supposed to just provide the money. That's all. You know, again, that's what my experience is. This gentleman was a commissioner of the county. I mean, big guy, you know, but he, being so influential, being so, he owns 5 funeral homes, so much money. But he could not touch the life of his kids. He says, you have done more for my son in 15 minutes than I've been able to do in the last 5 years. That's the story again and again and again. Well, who is it? Solomon says, train up a child in the way he must go. Even though he might goof around, he will come back. I just had to share this with you because all go through the same.
No, I agree that sometimes a parental voice doesn't get through. They've heard you say that so often that it just goes off. For that very reason, I ought to add that those children of mine are very close to me. I love them all. They love me. We're a close family. Do you understand? It's just that I missed out on a teenage era when I could have, I don't know, I could have shared more than I did. Now, I haven't given up now. But they're well into middle age with kids of their own.
I think this is one of the tragedies that I've observed being on some of our boards, et cetera, in our system, and where I hope what you've said will come true, we'll give an answer to our children, because I watch mine be influenced by good schools, and I pay a lot of money to send them to good Adventist schools, and yet the professors, when they struggled through the 70s with evolution, they tended to give credence to the current philosophical thought over the Word of God. Yeah. And you know, you would think that even a betting person would bet on the Word of God after a while, after a number of scientific theories come and go and come and go, that you wouldn't have to give in and try and make excuses for Scripture in order to answer the current theory that's going on as if it's going to be correct 10 years from now, which science shows that often the theory keeps changing as we learn more and more. And I think it is possibly a problem of human pride that we insist on putting our intellect above God's, and therefore we have to be able to interpret Scripture to fit our needs, or we insist on that our knowledge is sufficient that we judge God's Word.
Thank you. My knowledge of ancient Hebrew is somewhat deficient. So I cannot be very, very sure of how to interpret some of the Mosaic writings. But yet, my Waldensian ancestors knew. And they just read the simple Bible as they had it. They read the Latin of Jerome, I don't know. I appreciate your comments, all of you. If I could just leave you with one picture, what should be the direction that our church takes? We need to give instructions to our teachers in these 106 campuses around the world. They are silent. They are not giving the instruction that you're talking about, because they are not getting a clear-cut pattern of curriculum that they ought to be sharing with their students. So there's a lot that has to be done humbly and with our scholars on their knees to put together. I think we can actually rest our eternal welfare on the conclusions that I see coming from intelligent design. The research that's been done by Dembski, by this man, what's his name, Douglas Ox, and by his predecessor, this is Stephen Meyer. Their research is so irrefutable that the world of science cannot argue against it. You understand what I'm saying? That the scientists are very respectful. They may disagree, but they don't find serious fault with the logic behind these writings that I've referred to. So I think our church can give college teachers all around the world the green light to say, by all means, you can tell all of your neighbors and your colleagues from other institutions that you are teaching a creator God. We call him the designer, if you wish. Paul, you've got your hand up.
Yes, actually the church, I think, is starting to take up your suggestion. This summer, July, at least two divisions that I know of are hosting college teachers. What I hope is eventually they bring in secondary teachers, you know, as well, because they need to. Because of the comments about you lose them at 14, it's probably true. But they are trying to get those teachers acquainted with some of the facts that we have found out that have, you know, come through around the GRI. And so I think we're starting to see a little more noise made than we have in the past, and I think it's a very good thing.
Thank you. Thank you. By the way,
comment from Leonard Brand, too, and you had one, I think.
I agree. It's very important that we have these programs to get the teachers thinking about these things. and that will help. But there's also another factor that just that when the culture is losing its willingness to put the Bible first, then that's not going to fully solve the problem. If the kids don't get a solid basis when they're very young, it may not help. It will help, yeah. But we can't think that it's really going to solve all the problem.
One of the suggestions I make in this document, a loud voice for Adventist creationism, one of the suggestions is that it's time we tested the irrefutable data of intelligent design, test that with communities and groups of very well-informed scientists, because up till now, these scientists have been reluctant to answer. Behe told, in a lecture I heard him down at Biola, Behe assured the audience in my hearing that since he wrote his book, Darwin's Black Box, there has not been ever a successful rebuttal to the logic that he produces in his book. And I think that could be said also of more later. For example, the data in Stephen Meyer's book, Darwin's Doubt. We have enough solid data of which we do not need to apologize. And so even Loma Linda University, with its pride of its in its academics and its nervousness about being branded as a fundamentalist no-brain institution. No, nobody need apologize for saying we teach intelligent design and we follow the urgings of Philip Johnson, who said when it comes to designing a curriculum for all of your state universities, say in the curriculum summary, what we do here is we teach the controversy. We teach both sides of the issue. And that means that you're teaching creationism as well as hate.
A few years ago at Paradise, California, our church organized a committee, a creation study committee. And as officers, we met monthly. We laid out a year's program. We had public speakers come in for a creation Sabbath annually in several different activities. And here at Loma Linda, we are in a place here, as we have talked earlier, that these colleges, universities, they look to this place for leadership. And I am just wondering if out of our meeting today even, there can be a creation committee to really plan activities and special events for this entire area.
Oh, please do not get me going. I would love to see a part of the funding given now to, for example, the Geoscience Research Institute, which has done good work over the years. But when it comes to an issue which is foundational to our whole church and to its future, let us not dodge the issue. The future of our church and its effectiveness in its mission will be sacrificed if we do not find a way to present the identity of God as creator. Thou art worthy, for thou hast created all things. That's what the 24 elders said in Revelation 4.
But what kind of follow-up can we see develop, really, out of our discussion even today?
Well, we have people like Paul Geim here.
Yeah.
We have people like Leonard Brand, who, look, he's got here an excellent book. It's very heavy, by the way. Heavy with information and heavy with avoir du poids. Anybody who knows French knows that that means it weighs a lot. It's printed on excellent paper.
But again, here are individuals doing outstanding work individually, but yet as a church, we really are not functioning.
I agree. But as Paul warned us now a few minutes ago, there are things happening behind the scenes which are giving hope for things moving forward in ways which you're imagining. I would love to see something of the kind you describe. Yes. What we need desperately, people, since chronology is a major issue in the planetary history, the history of planet Earth, the chronology, it depends very much upon the whole history of the flood. And geology should point us in helpful directions there. That's another big story. And we've got lots of good experts we could invite here to. Yes, Denise.
I'm not really part of this community at all.
But well, of course you are.
Well, but the most impressive thing I've ever seen, and it's woven together. You put the artists and the scientific community together. And I think of the two words, celibate and celebrate, a joke my husband likes to tell. And it seems like you need to meld the two together. There was a man who was retired named Terry McComb, and he came through different...
Hold this up.
Oh, he was from Canada, and he and his wife would come through different areas of California and have a creation seminar for a weekend. Mm. And it would start out so simply that it just let the week fall away from your shoulders. And in the beginning, God created. And he had beautiful, beautiful pictures. And he would weave the newest scientific things that are coming out now, like things happening in the ocean and new discoveries and things that would just, it was awesome. And there was beautiful music playing softly in the background. It was like the Holy Spirit just blew through the weekend. And it was a celebration of life and all of these things put together. And it was something no one wanted to argue with.
When we put this group together, Janice, you're going to be in it. Well, thank you.
You know, one observation. Oh. Our Sabbath evening Vesper services here are generally very poorly attended. And I think that if, as creationists, that if we could offer some programs, we'd get at least, maybe one Vespers out of a quarter even, or even every 6 months. I think this would be a very timely thing.
Well, I appreciate your enthusiasm for that proposal. I think there is a certain reluctance to do anything very very loud and public on the campus because there are sufficient differences of conviction, sincere conviction now, serious differences that the university as an institution doesn't want to come down clearly and emphatically in one part of the discussion. So I respect that reluctance. I'm worried about it because sooner or later we have to put that timidity, that reluctance aside and say this is where we stand. I think for my part, where I want to take my stand is to say, I know. I have the utmost respect, Waldensian respect, for the Bible. And so I will accept the Mosaic writings as I read it, although I'm humble enough to know that the word as we have it, as I can read it, is subject to consideration and to perhaps understanding in different ways. So then, having taken my stand on and the data, the scientific data, of which I can be proud and adamant, taking my stand on that data, I can also say, when it comes to the process, the way God did it, the way that planet Earth developed, the way he destroyed the Earth with a flood, the process, there are various ways to look at that, and I know that there are differences of opinion, and I will do my very best to understand what the Bible tells me, but I will leave my final, maybe my ultimate conclusions open until someday in the earth made new, I will know how God did it all. But the process, you see, is one set where we have lots of details. We can spend a lot of time. Dr. Brand has spent ages up in the Grand Canyon studying animal footprints in the Coconita sandstone. Wonderful. And that is evidence in the writings he has published that these little animals actually made those footprints underwater, all right? Yeah, and that is a strong support for the evidence of a global flood. All right. I had doubts about certain aspects of geomorphology. That is, does the account of the flood have good support when I look at the layers of sedimentary sandstone around the Grand Canyon? The Coconino sandstone, it's estimated, has a total, this is sedimentary sandstone, mind you, has a total volume of about 10,000 cubic miles. 10,000 cubic miles of sediment? How do you get that much sediment in even an ocean of turbulent water being sloshed around over planet Earth? It's hard for me to comprehend. And the Navajo sandstone, which is a different layer altogether, they have estimated the volume of these strata by boring down, and in this area here, the Navajo sandstone is so many hundreds of feet thick, and in somewhere else it's maybe a bit less or a bit more. By making multiple boreholes over the whole area, hundreds of boreholes, they can pretty much come to a conclusion about the total volume of the sandstone. And they come up with a figure. Dr. Brand has his hand up, and I'm afraid he's going to take issue. Good on him. But this is what I have heard, and he's going to shed light on this whole issue. I cannot pretend to understand how these strata were laid down, although informed opinion suggests that there was a huge amount of strata denuded from the Appalachian Mountains at some stage of Earth's history. And we would have to conclude that that happened in the early stages of the flood. And then the sediment, the material in suspension were just deposited in times of calmness where the water was still. Now, I was concerned about geomorphology, and myself in Australia, I was worried about what they call planation surfaces. Do you know what planation surfaces are? Vast areas, hundreds of miles of Earth's surface that are flat, really flat. And there's one of those planation surfaces in Canada. There's one in northwestern Australia. And a few years ago, I went for a safari on northwestern Australia. And in a Land Cruiser, we went out trekking through there, and you could see for 100 miles, flat country, not barren, but just very dry. And here and there, on this flat landscape, there was a pile of rocks, maybe 100 feet or 150 feet, standing above the surface of the plain. And I remember one night as we had settled near one of these mountains to camp overnight, I decided I'd better kind of climb up one of these things to see what it's made of, what kind of a view I can have of the countryside up there. Remember, I'm wondering whether the planation surfaces are indeed what biblical geologists are saying they are, like a man like Michael Ord, whom Leonard Brand knows very well. If you have an ocean of water sweeping across a continent, it can take most of the surface off with it and leave just a flat surface behind, a planation. It's a surface made plain. So I climbed up this thing, up these rocks, till I reached the top. And I had to conclude that this pile of rocks was just a pile of rocks that somehow was too heavy for the water stream to be washed away. Up the top, it wasn't a very big area, but I had a magnificent view. I think I could see for 200 miles, as far as the eye could go. And then I fussed around, and there on the sand, at the top of this heap of stone, in the sand at the top of that heap of stones, was a seashell. A seashell. Proof enough for me, the top of this pile of stones at one stage was the bottom of an ocean of some kind. And that shell, it's only this big, I've got it on my shelf at home. It satisfied me that the theory of planation surfaces holds water, and it can be logically attributed to a fast-flowing sheet of water that sweeps the whole area of the tectonic plates clean of its overburden. Now, Paul, look, you've got to hold. Shut down this.
Yeah, well, we will allow a couple of final questions and comments, and then you can respond, and then we will.
Please do. Yes.
Well, your comments are very helpful, and they illustrate an important point, that is how difficult it is to be sure we understand something. And and I think part of our problem in our with all of our scholars is they're often very impressed by what the scientific community is saying, not realizing that they're only asking questions on one side of an issue, because their philosophy does not allow them to look at the other side. And these sandstones are an illustration. Yeah, there's an enormous amount, and that's impressive, but there are other parts of this that I find that the people out there are not asking. They're not asking the questions, and they're not noticing. They assume that all the sandstones and everything else was formed by the processes we see happening today. Yet there are features of that Navajo and that Coconino that simply are not explainable by what's happening today. And the most scientists are not asking about, they're not looking at that because it doesn't fit their philosophy. And if until we're willing to take the Bible seriously enough that we'll look at the other side, we'll be overawed by science.
Just as you urge us to take the Bible seriously, I suppose if we believe the water was turned into wine, I have no difficulty with just taking it, even though it makes no sense to me.
Faith
must come in.
I've heard people say that, well, if you turned the water into wine, the heat of that biochemical process would boil away the pots.
Yeah.
I have a suspicion that if God knows how to change water to wine, he'd know how to take care of the pots.
Hey, Roth, you have the last word so often, my friend.
It's not always correct, but you commented a little bit about these sandstone bodies. It's true, they're impressive. In fact, they're so impressive, I don't know how you explain them on the basis of present activity, which is assumed to be local. See, geology processes, a little bit goes on here, a little bit goes on there, and over a million years, you know, they claim we have great big changes. But when we go out there and look at those layers, they are so flat, one on top of another, over such widespread areas.
You take, I have been on a geology tour led by Dr. Ruth, and he will do his best to explain how these strata were laid down. Go ahead.
It's so much easier to explain these on the basis of some major catastrophic activity than on the basis of local activity that is going now on presently. For instance, the Chernarp conglomerate, you know, only maybe 100 feet thick, spread over five different states. How are you going to spread a layer just that thin over 500 states under ordinary conditions and have it continuous? This is impossible. You've got to have a major catastrophe to do that. We have, you go out there and look at other Dakota sandstone is far worse. You know, it's much more widespread. Same situation again, and you see one of these flat layers on top of the other, on top of the other, and then you note that there's parts of the geologic column missing. They say, "Oh, there's 100 million years missing here." No sign of significant erosion between these layers. Pretty hard to say. The long ages model is good. And it's pretty easy to say, boy, I can't explain this unless I believe the Bible.
Well, thank you. I think, Paul, we should thank you. You're a good host. And I don't want to leave this place without praying. Thank you. O Lord and Master, we have wrestled this morning with so many notions of how you brought this world and its life into being, and yes, how you manage it, and your graciousness in providing a plan to restore it, to bring it back to its original beauty. Lord, thank you for providing us with your word revealed through the prophets long ago. And we humbly accept that our human intelligence may not be sufficient to grasp all of the magnificence which you have made. But Lord, we bow now just in praise and in submission. And Lord, we express to you now, out of our uncertainties, we express our faith and our loyalty and our determination to speak for you as long as you give us breath. Thank you, Lord. We love you. Amen.